So now we move on to calculating the aggregate price level. Now, much like GDP, this is really relying on sort of a made-up thing, a made-up quantity. So concepts like inflation or deflation rely on an understanding of aggregate prices. But obviously, there are many different prices in the economy, and so how do we add them up? How do we compare them? Again, it's like adding apples and oranges, and so it's not obvious how to do this. If the prices of some goods go up and the prices of others go down, is there inflation or deflation? How do we compare these things? And so we'll talk about two common measures of aggregate prices. One is the implicit GDP deflator, and the other is the consumer price index. So the implicit GDP price deflator is one of the two most commonly used price level measures. And really, all it is you're taking nominal GDP in a year, dividing by real GDP in that year, and multiplying by 100. And so you can imagine that the further away nominal GDP is from real GDP, then the higher are these sort of imaginary prices when compared to real GDP. And so by convention, the price deflator is 100 in the base year. And this makes sense because we saw that nominal GDP and real GDP are the same in the base year. And obviously, it's going to depend on what method we use to calculate GDP. And so here's using our example of our economy before from real GDP. We can see that depending on the base year used, we get different measures of inflation. We get different measures of growth of the GDP price deflator, right? So if we use base year 2002, the inflation between 2002 and 2003, which is just the growth rate of this GDP price deflator, is 66%. But if we use base year 2003, the growth rate between 2002 and 2003 is 71%. So you can see that again, it depends on the base year we use, much like real GDP does. The other way of measuring this is the consumer price index. And I say here it's the most commonly used price level measure. In fact, this is the price level measure used by many central banks. So the Bank of Canada relies when it calculates inflation mainly on the consumer price index. And so the aim is to calculate the changes in the total price of a fixed bundle of goods and services that consumers usually purchase. So you find this bundle of things that people generally tend to buy. You've set some quantities, so maybe people tend to buy, I don't know, 10 tomatoes in a year, one lamp, two TVs, whatever. That's your bundle, and then you track how the total price of that bundle changes from year to year. Importantly here, this includes things that consumers buy, so food, rent, college tuition, gas. It does not include things that consumers don't buy, or perhaps things that firms buy. So it doesn't include crude oil. Very few consumers are buying crude oil. Very few consumers are buying factory equipment. They're not buying intermediate goods in general. They're not buying, I don't know, large quantities of screws, for example. And so these are not included in the consumer price index. And so in practice, then we fix a base year, obtain the quantities of goods and services consumed by households in that base year using expenditure surveys, and then we calculate the price of that bundle. So you'll notice here again, this all will depend on the base year because it could be that the quantities of goods in these bundles change over time. Using an example from before, in 1980, people didn't tend to buy computers or internet. So if we use the 1980 bundle for CPI today, it would be very misleading about what the price level faced by consumers is. So mathematically, this is the consumer price index. So it would be the cost of base year quantities at current prices. So this is, we figure out what that bundle of goods is in the base year, and we multiply it by current prices, what the prices are today. We divide by the cost of that same bundle at base year prices. So that is the price they cost in the base year, and we multiply by 100. CPI and the GDP deflator generally give similar pictures of inflation. So here we have inflation measured by the GDP deflator and inflation measured by CPI between 1962 and, I believe, 2018. And you'll notice that they tend to track each other. They're never exactly equal, or that is, they're rarely exactly equal, but they do tend to track each other. So what are problems with measuring real GDP and the price level? So one is that the quality of goods changes over time. So you can imagine that when we're measuring these things, perhaps we shouldn't weight cars today the same as cars 20 years ago. Cars today are very different. Cars today have more safety features. They have things like satellite radio. They have things like blind spot sensors, automatic parking, things like that. And so the quality of cars today is very different than the quality of cars 20 years ago or 30 years ago. And so when we're adding up, for example, cars for real GDP, perhaps we should weight cars today more than cars 30 years ago because of this higher quality. And so if we don't correct for this quality, and in fact, statistical agencies do try to account for this quality, this tends to exaggerate inflation. So to give you an example of this, you can imagine, as I said, that the quality of cars is going up over time. And likewise, because the quality of cars is going up, their price might also be going up at a similar rate, perhaps less, but at a similar rate. Now, the reason the price is going up is because the quality is going up. So, in a sense, it's not that the price per car is going up, it's that the quality has increased, and so as a result, the price is going up. And so, as a result, if we don't correct for this, this will tend to exaggerate inflation. It will seem like the price of cars has gone up more than it has, given that the quality has increased. Likewise, new goods and services appear all the time, right? And so how do we value them? And it can be tricky. Again, to give you this example, I mean, computers, personal computers or laptops didn't exist 40 years ago. So if we're ever using a base year of 1960, I mean, that doesn't make sense for today. It doesn't include things that we consume today, like computers. Here's my tweet, or I have two tweets for this. This one comes from Adam Tooze, who is a historian and economist at Columbia. And he tweets out this graph, which shows the price levels, or the CPI price index, for two different things. One is goods, excluding food and energy, and the other is services. And in particular, as I mentioned before, a large portion of services is rent or housing payments. You'll notice that the price of goods in general has not increased that much since 1995, whereas the price of services, in particular rent or housing costs, has gone up substantially. And so Tooze points out, when price trends are as divergent as the notion of inflation in a comprehensive sense, or sorry, let me restart this. When price trends are this divergent, then the notion of inflation in a comprehensive sense begins to lose its meaning, and with it, also the clear intent behind central bank mandates of price stability. And so his point here is that we could measure aggregate inflation using the tools we just learned, but it really loses that there are some goods which are having their prices increase substantially, while other goods aren't seeing as large of a price increase. And so this might give us a different picture than if all goods prices were increasing lockstep. We're all increasing at the same rate. The other comes from Atif Mian, who is an economist at the University of Chicago. So he says, feel that your kids are not learning as much remotely? Well, at least the GDP will reflect your feeling. The Bureau of Economic Analysis lowered the contribution of education towards GDP by increasing the price deflator due to these disruptions. So this refers back to what we were talking about these changes in quality. So the point is that because students including yourselves, I suppose, are learning from home, are learning remotely, and the claim is that this learning has a lower quality than going to school, going to a classroom, well, then we should reflect that in GDP. And the way you do it is by increasing the price deflator. So in other words, it's as if we're now getting less per dollar spent when we buy education.